talks, if I can give a bit of unsolicited advice, well, the first of much unsolicited advice, would be, you know, just try to identify 5 or 10 points that you feel like you'd like to take away from this, rather than trying to digest everything, because there's a huge amount of information here. And it's specifically weighted towards kind of heavy content, specifically because you guys are pretty smart. This isn't something where this is, you know, Neuro 101 light. This is like Neuro 458, you know, kind of stuff. So with that said, it's specifically designed like that. We're going to be going through a number of different things in the context of what we're going to be talking about today. The first group is we're going to talk about neurological assessment and things like that. Then we're going to be talking about some specifics with regard to traumatic brain injury, vascular insult, and stroke, and then finish up, if we've got time, with regard to some other thoughts with regard to craniotomy. This is also flavored in the way that we really like to run our practice, which is that we really consider nurses and ancillary medical personnel, which I'm just going to lump in together with nurses, as part of the treatment team. You guys are very much a continuum with treatment between physicians, nurses, allied personnel, health personnel, etc., physical therapists, occupational therapists, speech therapists, everything. We really regard that as a comprehensive treatment team. This is not the traditional hierarchical, position here, and everyone else is down here. We really regard everyone as kind of on the same playing field. And I hope that we give you that impression when we work with you all and participate in patient care together. Feel free to stop me as we go through here, and please, if I'm talking too fast or mumbling, both of which I have a habit of doing, please slow me down. As we look at a neurological assessment in a neuro patient, a lot of folks don't like neuro from a treatment standpoint because, a lot of folks don't like neuro because the patients can be difficult. They can have pain issues, they can be altered, they can be honestly a real challenge. You know, take an average neuro patient versus an average straightforward ortho patient. It's a night and day difference. The ortho patient is likely going to be a younger, healthier patient who wants to get through their knee surgery or their ankle surgery and be gone. Whereas a neuro patient may have a much more complex issue, and that's typically what drives a lot of those of us that practice neuro into neuros, because we really appreciate the complexity of that. Let's talk for a moment about some of the key components as we look at our neuro assessment. Let's start with vital signs. And I've got a couple of vital signs listed here: blood pressure, pulse, respiratory rate. I'm missing two key ones. What are those? Temperature and pain, of course, right? And when we talk about the blood pressure, pulse, and respiratory rate on patients in particular, a lot of this is straightforward stuff. I will tell you that we tend, obviously, with neuro patients, to really want to maximize blood pressure, especially with any type of traumatic brain injury, which we'll talk about in a second. Cushing's triad is a famous triad, and several times per year, each of us will get a call and say, oh my gosh, this patient's bradycardic and hypertensive. And that typically is an ominous finding in a completely obtunded, comatose patient with a bad brain injury. It's a meaningless finding, or not a very important finding, in a patient who's chatting and finishing up their meal. And so, as with anything in neuro, you really want to make sure that you take this in context. A patient who's had an acute alteration in their neurological status, followed by bradycardia and hypertension, means that they've got an intracranial finding until proven otherwise. And those are the patients that you want to start packing up and getting the CT scan as you're calling, and making sure that that sounds like a reasonable plan. Level of consciousness. You know, I think this is the biggest challenge for the neuro patients that we were just talking about, because a lot of these patients have an altered level of consciousness. And I think it's really important to add a couple thoughts specifically regarding evaluation of level of consciousness. I don't care if they're fully awake or completely comatose, but the job of doing continuous or repeated neurological assessments is to get multiple data points. You can establish a trend. Yep, this patient, yeah, they're arousable, they follow some simple commands, they're moving everything okay, then that's a meaningful trend. If you've got a trend here where they're awake, alert-oriented times 3, and then you're at your next assessment, they're obtunded, the first question you have to ask yourself is, what am I missing? You know, what has happened in this last hour or 2 hour or 4 hour interval? You know, typically it's going to be a medication type of thing. Could it be a neurological catastrophe? You bet it could. So when you come into a room and you're identifying a neuro patient, and a lot of times you'll see us pinch these patients and really try to assess them and really try to get them going. And so I've talked a little bit about this before at some of the hospitals, but I have a very straightforward way of doing a neurological assessment that I think if they can satisfy these couple of basic criteria, they're okay. You know, I'm not saying this is the best exam nor the most complete exam, but if they can say something meaningful to you, how are you? I'm fine. How are you? Rather than gobbledygook, that's number one. Can they communicate in some way and say something? Number two, can they follow some simple commands? Following commands is the single most important part of your neurological assessment. And so if you can have them do a drift, which means palms up like they're holding a pizza or a turkey, palms up and keep their elbows off the bed, and they can do that for at least 5 seconds with their eyes closed, they're 90% of the way you need them to be, okay? If they can't follow that command, and that's not a super easy thing to do, then that's an important finding. And then typically I'll have them say something to me, I'll have them hold up their hands, elbows off the bed, palms up like this, and then I'll have them wiggle their toes. If they can follow those quick little commands, your super quick neuro assessment is checked, it's done. Now, that's not the best neuro assessment. We all know how to do a complete neurological assessment, oriented times three and everything else. But a lot of times you guys are busy. A lot of times we're all busy. And what's most important is identifying a meaningful, quick neurological assessment. And if they can do that quick neurological assessment, plus engage with you meaningfully, that's 90% of the battle. Okay? By the way, if they start doing this and they start fading like this, that's called a pronator drift, right? And that's an important assessment. That means that they have a very subtle neurological finding, and this is the most subtle way to get this. And typically that's a hemispheric problem with the left side or the left side of the brain or the right side of the brain. So quick and dirty way of doing it, but sometimes on the front lines, you know, a quick neuroassessment is better than no neuroassessment. Okay? It's also very important that if you really can't arouse them, I typically suggest grab one of your colleagues, say, hey, I can't get the guy in bed three to do anything. Can you see? And that's an important finding. I went in to one of the hospitals in the middle of the night the other night to an unresponsive patient. And, you know, I did my typical thing. I did a nipple twist because it's really important. I mean, if you can't get them up and a couple different people have tried, you've got to try anything possible within reason to get them going. Now, do I do an aerial or twist on everyone? Good Lord, no. I do, please call me out. But is it extraordinarily important in this case for a patient with an epidural hematoma to actually make sure they can get up and do something? You bet it is. You bet it is. And so, you know, escalating your level of stimulation sometimes is super important. You're going to save people a lot of driving time, but much more important, you're going to be able to deliver good quality care. So don't be afraid to escalate your level of stimulation to a reasonable, appropriate level, typically with a colleague present. You know, we talked something about the Glasgow Coma Scale, and you know, there's a lot of nuances. Always induced cerebral posturing, disease decorticate posturing. The key thing on the Glasgow Coma Scale is, can they follow commands or can they not follow commands? That's a hard line. Call it the Mason Scale of two. Can they or can't they? If they can follow commands, and they can, and following commands also equals opening their eyes and say something meaningful, then you're again, 90% of the way there. If they can't, whether they're localizing is very important. Localization to a stimulus is very different than just moving around. Okay, and that's one of the other key things, if you will, about a more complex neurological assessment, typically found in the ICU, that's important. If they can localize to that stimulation, that's a meaningful finding and a good finding. That means they're just below the level of being able to follow commands. Now, it's a little hard, because a lot of times we'll be sternal rubbing them or stimulating them here or tickling them there in the armpit and providing some noxious stimulus, but it's a little bit difficult because, you know, what if they're drawing up, but it's just a reflexive draw up like that? So change your inner stimulus. If their hands are up here, stimulate down on the hip, okay? In other words, keep your brain in the loop and stimulate in different areas so that you can really identify, is it localization because they're bringing their arm now down to get your hand away, or are they still going up? If they're still going up, when you're stimulating down on the hip, for example, that's a more ominous finding, okay? There's a big difference between following commands and not following commands. And the Mason-Glasgow Coma Scale 2 can follow commands versus not following commands is kind of the key thing. Speech is super important, and we're not going to beat this one to death because everyone pretty much can understand and appreciate this. I will say, though, that the quality of the speech is really important. Are they getting everything out appropriately, but they're just kind of slurring it out, versus they can't really speak, and or they're speaking in word salad, okay? And different areas will have different areas of localization. If this is a new neurological finding, this patient requires an evaluation by typically a neurologist or us, and typically imaging right away, all right? Medications typically won't alter your ability to speak unless you're comatose, all right? Cranial nerves. I think cranial nerves are something that all of us find very interesting. I guess that's I'm speaking to from a very biased perspective. I find them really interesting. Do you guys find them interesting? Cranial nerves are kind of the key to a basic neurological assessment. We all know this. A couple of key thoughts with regard to cranial nerves. If we've done brain surgery, then when I say brain surgery, I mean any area above the ears or any area in the supratentorial compartment, then it's unlikely that we're going to have significant alteration in cranial nerves. Cranial nerves probably on the non-sick, non-ill patients don't need to be assessed on a regular basis other than pupillary dilatation. Anisocoria or difference in pupillary size is an important finding in a patient who has problems in their brain. If the patient's had back surgery and they have anisocoria, it's less of a significant finding. 20% of patients will have anisocoria at a baseline, and not a worrisome finding. If the patient's awake, alert, oriented times three, and they have anisocoria, again, it's a less critical finding. If the patient's had a neurologic deterioration and they have anisocoria, it's a neurological emergency. Okay. So again, keeping our brain in the loop and assessing, you know, the whole picture here is super important. The other thing, question that I will always ask is, has your pupil always been bigger than the other one? A lot of times the answer will be yes, and this is in the awake patient that we're talking about. So anisocoria in the right context, and a neurological emergency. Anisocoria in the typical context of an awake and oriented patient, not as much of an important issue. Swallowing reflexes and gag reflexes are very important to assess in patients who've had cerebellar surgery or surgery in the area of the cranial vertebral junction. In other words, in the back of the head or below the level of the ear. And that's really important for a variety of reasons. These patients that are much higher risk of aspiration, much higher risk of associated pneumonias, a much higher risk of having malnutrition because they can't eat. And so having swallow evaluations, formal or informal, I think are really important on those patients. And a lot of times we'll forget or be focused on other things. And I think that's a great team effort in terms of making sure that these patients can do that. Double vision is my last comment when it comes to cranial nerves. Double vision is an important finding in the right context. I typically will ask, is it horizontal? Is it vertical? And, you know, are the double vision to the side or on top of one another as two things? The other thing I'll ask is, can you close one eye and you still have little vision? If the answer is yes, then typically it's not anything we need to worry about because that's more of a psychiatric type of issue 99 times out of 100. Motor function, well, this is a tough one because a lot of us, you know, this is a huge concern, especially for patients who've had spinal surgery, and it's very important for us to get a good assessment on this. We talked about the quick and dirty assessment. When you're truly assessing a patient and getting to know them for the first time, for example, on a given shift, I think these are really important findings. If a patient's in spinal surgery, the first question I'll typically ask is, where do you have pain before surgery? And they'll say, you know, gosh, my right leg hurt like that. And then the next question I ask is, did you have weakness with that? It's like, yeah, I did, or no, I didn't. But understanding their baseline before surgery is super important to assessing their function after surgery or after the injury. And understanding the differences between those. Well, does it still hurt now? Yes or no. Sometimes we'll replace pain with numbness. because that's part of the recovery process. We've taken away the insult, if you will, we've taken away the insult on the nerve, but we can't necessarily make the nerve better. The nerve has to get better by itself. So a lot of times folks will come in and they'll say, yeah, my leg, it doesn't hurt anymore, but it's numb as could be. Well, then assess that. You know, is this the same area where you had pain and now you've got numbness? That's a better finding. Now, if it's new numbness, which can sometimes occur, typically that's numbness that will resolve with time, but documenting that, and then getting multiple data points, or weakness, getting multiple data points so that we really know where we're going with this, rather than just saying, oh yeah, the patient's got numbness, oh yeah, the patient's got weakness. Is it new? Is it old? Is it progressing during your shift? Is the numbness getting worse or getting better? Multiple data points in neurological assessment, especially for neurological differences, are really important. A single isolated data point, left leg weak, not super helpful. Multiple data points saying leg is getting weaker, very important, okay? Or, to the contrary, getting better, also very important, okay? Anti-gravity, it's the difference between level 2 and level 3, that's kind of the key. It's kind of the key thing. So if they can move their leg in the plane of the bed, but they can't lift it off the bed, that's the difference between 2 and 3, okay? 4 and 5, obviously 5 is normal, 4 is pretty strong, but just not quite normal. 3 is noticeably weak, okay? And everyone, we've all got our own way of kind of assessing this, and obviously part of this is experience. But I mean, I guess importantly, just consistency amongst you is important. If it was a 3 last time, then hopefully it's going to be a 3 this time if it's the same strength. All right, any questions? Which side of the brain's got more neurons, anybody know? Anybody? I got this wrong. It was, it's the left side. Left side's got more. And it really has to do with language function typically resides on the left side. And 90, if you're right-handed, 99% of us will have left side of brain function. If you're left-handed, 95% of us will have left side of brain function. Excuse me, left side of language function. Okay, so neurological assessment. I think my summary there would be get multiple data points if you can, especially in a patient who isn't normal. Number one, make sure that you're focusing on the area that you're most concerned. Number three, in an awake, oriented, appropriate patient, neurological findings are less concerning. In the patient who's comatose or otherwise altered, any neurological finding is significantly worse. Lastly, grab a colleague, grab a friend, grab a fellow nurse. If you're concerned or don't feel like you've got a good assessment or a good handle on that assessment, two sets of eyes are better than one. Traumatic brain injury. You know, a lot of times the feedback we'll get on traumatic brain injury is the damage is done. You know, car accident, a fall, something else. Typically traumatic, almost always tragic, almost always unintended. Damage is done. Let's see how much better they can get by themselves. And that's kind of the old way of thinking. What we're really appreciating with traumatic brain injury is, first of all, prevention obviously is super important. Specifically, avoiding repeated injury is super important. But then also preventing secondary injury. And that's where everyone in this room can really play a role and really where the exciting research with traumatic brain injury is going. It's pervasive throughout our society, more common in males, more common in the teens, 20s, and 30s in those males. And it really represents a heterogeneous group of injuries, okay? It can be traumatic, an epidural hematoma, a contusion or a bruise. Diffuse axonal injury is always a scary one for us. Subdural hematomas, subarachnoid hemorrhage is a variant of that we'll talk a little bit about. Diffuse brain swelling, typically associated with axonal brain injury. All these types of heterogeneous components can be found. I saw, I think it was in medical school, the New England Journal of Medicine published a picture, and it had represented on this single slice, epidural, subdural, traumatic subarachnoid hemorrhage, intracerebral hemorrhage, and intraventricular hemorrhage, all within one cut. And they published it because it was obviously a unique picture. And I imagine that patient didn't do especially well. But prevention of secondary injury is really what we're going to talk about and focus on for the next couple of minutes. Physiology, obviously the brain requires oxygen. When we all kid about the fact that the brain versus the heart is the most important organ of the bottom, or excuse me, of the body. And where that phrase at this point. Versus gastroenterology, where they think the gut is the most important organ of the body. From a pure physiologic standpoint, the brain probably is. So you can go home and say, yep, I definitely work for the most important organ of the body. And specifically because once we're past that 3.5 or 4 minute window when it comes to oxygenation, that part of the brain is done. In the heart, that is true to some extent as well, although if a portion of the heart is starved for oxygen, other portions of the heart can pick up for that. I guess the same thing applies to the brain, so maybe the argument still goes. Increased brain pressure is probably the first thing we'll talk about because it's what slide is next. But perhaps more importantly, it's also the basic fundamental philosophy here. And that is that our head has a built-in helmet, helmets included, if you will. And anything that's there is there, and anything that's new needs to push the normal stuff out of the way. And that's really the Monroe-Kelly doctrine, where you've got brain, plus spinal fluid, plus all the other contents that are normally there. And our body has evolved over the course of the last couple of hundred of millions of years to have a pretty good ratio, and it seems to work. So then when we start adding other components, a bullet, a blood clot, an area of brain that has died, that's swelling, then other parts of the brain, by the very nature, have to compensate. Primary brain injury, I think, is the key thing here when we talk about the initial insult, the ischemia, the hypoxia, or the shear injury, some type of insult to the brain. And this is, a great quote, kind of summarizes it all. It takes very little energy for us to scramble an egg, but everything we know about this world, we can't unscramble an egg. And I think the same thing goes in the brain. Once that brain is injured, we can't uninjure that brain. What we can do is prevent that secondary brain injury. We can prevent the hypoxia, the hypotension, the increased intracranial pressure, which therefore reduces the amount of cerebral perfusion, metabolic disturbances, other secondary issues such as seizures, which cause hypoxia, hypotension, and all those kinds of things. I think this is, if you wanted to take home a kind of a busy slide, but an important slide. Inflammatory cytokines is at the top for a reason. It's probably, at the end of the day, what we will, from a pharmacological standpoint, develop to limit the amount of secondary damage, because it's the inflammatory cytokines that are released throughout the body and in the brain that really have a significant negative impact on outcomes with patients with traumatic brain injuries. Vasogenic edema, cerebral edema, cytotoxic edema, they all lead, if you will, to this cascade of issues that can really cause problems. Mitochondrial decoupling, not uncoupling, if you want to change your hand up. So traumatic brain red flags, altered level of consciousness, really, no kidding, right? But specifically, a declining neurological exam in a traumatic brain injury or any neuro patient is really key here. I always call it, what's our baseline? Post-operative, what's our new baseline? The patient arrives in the ER, what is their new baseline? And then that's where we're going. A lot of times we'll get a call in the middle of the night, or the middle of the day for that matter, and it'll be Mrs. Jones is now she can't do this, she can't talk, she can't move her right arm. And typically that sets off a cascade of calls and work and energy and effort on our end to try to identify why Mrs. Jones can't do that. And if you ever get the response on the other end, okay, thanks, that's probably you're not talking to the right person. It's not that we're inquisitive, that we are, I guess, inquisitive, but we really want to know why Mrs. Jones can't do this or can't do that. And so when we talk about red flags, if you're calling us with a red flag, then typically we want to know why that is. Now, maybe we expected that. Maybe we expected that Mrs. Jones wouldn't be able to move her right arm anymore. And that's just that. But it's okay for you guys to say, do we know why? What's going on here? Because sometimes the message is getting miscommunicated, and that's an important thing, communication with all of us. Or sometimes you're talking to the wrong person, or sometimes I don't know what the reason or rationale is, but if you don't have an answer by the end of that call as to what's going on or what are we going to do about it, then there's a problem. and that requires a second call or a second form of communication saying, okay, what are we going to do? Are we going to transfer the patient? Are we going to scan? Or are we going to, you know, bang the patient? Are we going to give them a cup of coffee? And how do you want to treat this? And that's a very okay thing to say. Because a lot of us is, sometimes you just mentally want to check that off. You know, maybe we're on the sign-out rounds, you want to get the heck out of Dodge. That's fine. But sometimes that's not the case. And importantly, we're all in this for the same reason, that's patient. People are asymmetric, we talked about this. Other red flags, seizures. An isolated seizure in a patient that's got an intracranial finding, not a big deal. Repeated seizures, big problem. A repeated vomiting, double vision. A lot of these will go together. Worsening headache. Well, a lot of these patients have headaches, but a headache that's worsening and then all of a sudden they're having pronator drift or they're having some double vision or they're having some difficulty speaking or other kinds of things, a lot of times these red flags will go together, as you all know. Unusual behavior, not in your specialists, but in your patients. Slurred speech, a numbness and tingling in the arms or legs are all super important findings. There are some guidelines that we use, and guidelines are just that. They don't necessarily apply to everyone, and nor should they be used in every scenario. But they're the kinds of things that we typically talk about, and there have been some suggestion that full adoption of these guidelines decrease expenditures and increase patient good outcome. So certainly there are some important things to be noted. Some really important things are the first two things on this slide, which is blood pressure and oxygenation. Blood pressure is super important, and I know I'm preaching to the choir here. A systolic of less than 90. What happens below 90 is that our brain loses the ability to auto-regulate. Okay? Anywhere above 90 millimeters of mercury, our brain can automatically normally perfuse the entire brain. Okay? So if it's at the blood pressure is at systolic of 91, then what it does is it really cranks down those small blood vessels that are the feeding blood vessels called the arterioles. And as a result, the little capillaries don't notice a difference at all. You can have a blood pressure of 140, same thing. And what they do in that case is crank down even further. Blood pressure 91, they're cranked down, but not very far. And they're kind of dilated. And then all of a sudden at 90 and 89 and 85 and 80, they can't dilate anymore. They can't give any more blood. And so you lose the magic of autoregulation, okay? And that's why, you know, systolic of 90 is there for a good reason. And something that, above all else, we should really take very seriously. Trendelenburg was developed to maximize this number, systolic blood pressure, okay? And so super important thing. Oxygenation obviously goes without saying. We don't use blood gases as often anymore because we've got really good pulse oximeters. And in fact, that's an accurate assessment. The Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, which is one of those fancy equations that the neurophysiologists use, say that the the PaO2, which is what's in a blood gas, is not as accurately reflective of the oxygenation of the blood as is your pulse ox. So pulse ox is better than a blood gas. But oxygenation is super important. And we've all seen alteration of mental status with hypoxia. And again, something super important to keep in mind. Patients who are on pain medicines, it's really important. Those are the patients from a neuro patient that may have had a bit back whack. His knee probably lost a lot of blood. And so they're hypotensive already. And then all of a sudden they become a little hypoxic because you give them another 2 of Dilaudid because that's what you felt that they needed and you're trying to control that pain. But there's a fine line there between oxygenation. And oxygenation goes without saying. Mannitol we use in emergencies. We don't do mannitol drips. We give it in bolus form and honestly, it works well. I skipped that slide because it's not super important. The DVT prophylaxis, we're pretty aggressive in our group. If you go work in different parts of the country, you'll find that folks are less aggressive about DVT prophylaxis. But it's super important for a variety of reasons beyond the obvious. I think the single most important thing about DVT prophylaxis is that it takes, especially in routine spine patients, it takes a patient who has a very low risk category. And if we're not doing that DVT prophylaxis, it makes them into a much higher risk category. And it takes what ordinarily can be a very routine surgery into a potential death trap. And so, especially patients who are bed-bound, you know, expected them in the hospital for 2 days, but they're in the hospital for a week and a half because of this or that. Those are the patients that really require DVT prophylaxis. So when you're reviewing those MARs in those patients, if you're saying, gosh, this patient is not on Lovenox, or isn't on a sub-Q heparin, it's always a reasonable question to ask why. Typically, we'll be starting those patients on DVT prophylaxis within a couple days. And those are the kinds of things from a team approach that we always appreciate. Back to the more of the head injury type of patient. ICP monitoring, we typically use ventriculostomy rather than the old-fashioned bolts. The reason we use ventriculostomies is very simply because we can monitor and treat those patients that have intracranial pathology. Typically, we'll place ventrix into patients who have an alteration of mental status, typically on a GCS of 3 to GCS of 8. What is a brick or a stone have? What's the GCS of a brick or a stone? Yeah, and so it's always, you know, it seems like it ought to be zero, right? I mean, especially, you know, patients that are that ill can still have a number that sounds like, hey, at least it's not zero, but, you know, in actuality it is. Very importantly, though, when it comes to ventricular drainage, is that it's truly a fluid column. It's as though we have a clear hose and we've got a tube of water within that hose, and we go up and down, and that fluid goes up and down. And so having a unobstructed column of fluid is, number one, very important, and number two, making sure that fluid drains appropriately. A lot of times, I would recommend that when you come in and you get signed in, you're doing your assessment on a patient that's got a ventric. The very first thing I do on rounds, every single time I go see a patient, is I take that off the clip and I drop it down and make sure that fluid column works. Okay, if that fluid column isn't working, it's nice to know at the beginning of your shift so you're not sitting there banking your assessment on this patient on a fluid column that's not a continuous fluid column. So take it off, drop it down, see if that starts draining more. You're draining a cc of fluid off. I could care less about that, nor could my partners. What we care about is that patient's is this lifeline to the patient still working well? Okay. There is some contention about whether or not you do draining continuously versus not continuously. There are some pros and cons of each. Okay. And the answer is, it really just is somewhat patient dependent. Okay. Again, ICP monitoring indications. We do our best to try to do this. If a patient's got a decline in neurological status and one of the guys or gals is coming in to assess the patient, it's a perfectly reasonable thing as you, as a part of the team, say, hey, do we need some more monitoring here? Do we need to put a ventric in? Patients who have an acute neurological status changes that we need to go to the operating room for, sometimes we'll throw a ventric in while waiting for the OR, okay? So very reasonable. From a monitoring standpoint, there are some waveforms. And I'll be super honest with you, these are really hard to see on the fly. If you really want to look at these, you need to print them out usually. A triphasic waveform is ideal for these. And once every year, I'll see it. and we monitor a lot more frequently than that. But more importantly is a dampened waveform. Make sure your scales are right. A lot of our monitors have auto scales. That's fine. But sometimes you really need to ramp that up to appreciate that. If a patient doesn't have a skull flap, you can even tap lightly on the surface of that brain, and you can actually watch that. That's a perfect assessment tool to ensure that you've got a good waveform. Don't use your reflex hammer, please. There are also some abnormal waveforms that sometimes we'll see. We call these Lundberg waveforms, or more commonly, Tombstone waveforms. Importantly, these are infrequently seen and probably not worthy of further discussion at this point, but my point here is that if we've got a good repeatable waveform, much like an arc line if you're in the ICU, then we're good. If you've got a good fluid column, then we're good, all right? The ICP monitoring is part of a vital sign, and I think we can include this in our set of vital signs. It's not the most important thing. The most important thing in a patient is still neurological assessment. Let's talk for a moment, and I really wanted to mention this earlier, but truly I got nervous in front of all you guys and I forgot. The sedation and neurochecks. And this is really where I think it's important that when you first are coming on shift and you're coming to assess a patient, it's it's really important to take that sedation off. Okay, if there's a really good reason to have it on, that's fine. But 9 times out of 10, it's perfectly reasonable to pull that sedation off. Okay, sometimes it'll come off really quick. Sometimes, as you know, it'll take quite a while. But having a good baseline for yourself, because we rely on your eyes, your ears, your hands. Having a good assessment for yourself is incredibly important, and that needs to be our field of sedation. Besides CSF drainage, besides mannitol, hyperventilation is something that used to be used a lot. And the reason we don't use this as much anymore is because hyperventilation also causes vasoconstriction. Vasoconstriction leads to, obviously, decreased perfusion in the brain, which can cause problems. So we don't use hyperventilation as frequently. But we will use hyperventilation if the patient's herniated. Okay? And so it is perfectly reasonable. If you've got a patient in the ICU or in the ER that is herniating, there are a couple of obvious things you should do. You should be calling your surgeon. You should be maximally CSF draining, which means minus 10, whatever. You should be making sure they're getting typically some type of hyperosmolar agent, such as mannitol. And you can blow these patients down. Okay? An end tidal of 20 or 25 in a patient who is herniating and dying in front of you is an okay thing. It's suboptimal for the long term, but I've saved many lives by hyperventilation. Okay? If you can buy yourself 10 or 15 minutes while we're getting stuff ready, then you save a lot. Sedation is super important for patients, mainly because most of our neuro patients are crazy, but also because it allows a lower ICP. And it allows for the patient to have a safer patient environment, which is also very important. Elevation of the head of the bed is the single most important thing you can do in an immediate setting other than hyperventilation. Okay? Removal of that collar. A lot of times these trauma patients, TBI patients will have a collar on. Removal or loosening that, making sure you can get a hand in on either side, also incredibly important and valuable. Jugular compression is a big problem. Cerebral perfusion, we talk about CPP. CPP is a little bit more difficult than a lot of us make it sound when we're just kind of quickly talking about it. CPP is a very important number, and it's well established that having a CPP above a certain threshold, and often we'll set 70 as a threshold, is meaningful. The challenge with regard to CPPs is that we don't know what the higher number is that's good. Okay, and that's a real challenge. So I think in your head you should think of a cerebral perfusion pressure of 70 to 90 is probably an ideal number. But that 90 actually might be a little too high. Okay, brain oxygen monitoring is something that we don't do, mainly because the research really doesn't support it. We happy to try Lycox and other types of monitors, which some of your colleagues might use in the university setting, but it's really just a research data at this point. The biggest problem with brain tissue monitoring is that it's the microenvironment that is a problem. So if you've got ischemia going on here, and your Lycox is here, then you don't have any accurate data. And instead, you're hanging the hat on the fact that your Lycox monitor number shows a good number. Whereas, in fact, you might have a profound issue here. So we haven't figured out that yet. We'll probably end up doing microdialysis on CSF in the next 5 to 10 years is the most accurate way to assess that. So I got this question wrong, too. What travels faster? World's fastest car or signal in the brain? The Bugatti actually travels 15 miles an hour faster. So we're going to have a company car. We're going to call it the Neuro. Got a couple more minutes and a few more things to talk about. And I'm going to fly through that to get to this. TBI algorithm, I think the important thing is, and we've all had these patients in different contexts at the different hospitals, whether it's in the ICU or beyond. My key point of emphasis here is maximizing our treatment, because we really are trying to avoid secondary injury. I'll also remind you that secondary injury can occur very quickly. And so these are some of the most intense patients that we have in our experience. And I can remember, as just looking around some of the different nurses, different patients that we've taken care of over the course of the years. And I think it's important to remember that secondary injury is as bad, if not worse, than the original insult. So take these patients seriously. We can have meaningful outcomes. That's what we're after, meaningful outcomes with these patients. Let's talk about some vascular issues just briefly, because that's one of the things I like. Brain aneurysms, they can bleed. Most brain aneurysms don't bleed, right? The likelihood of your aneurysm bleeding in your brain is extraordinarily small. But unfortunately, it does occur. And when it does, it's a stroke. Okay, it's a special kind of stroke. It's a subarachnoid hemorrhage, but it's a stroke. And typically, it's described as the worst headache of their life. Some patients will have a sensible hemorrhage, and then they feel fine. And then the big hemorrhage occurs subsequently thereafter. These days, with pretty good CT scanners, the likelihood of missing a subarachnoid hemorrhage is pretty small, although we had one not too long ago that was missed. The lumbar puncture is typically the secondary diagnostic modality, and it typically works. Patients who have had subarachnoid hemorrhage are very ill, or can be very ill, and they can be quickly become more ill with rehemorrhage. 14% of patients will have an immediate rehemorrhage, and 50% of patients will have a hemorrhage within the first 30 days, which is why we treat these with some real urgency and some concern. Typically, these patients will have either clipping or coiling done, the data actually, everyone said, a lot of patients will come to the office with an aneurysm and say, oh, well, everyone coils now. Well, the data has only shown that for ruptured aneurysms, coiling is best in patients who are over 55. It's the only data that's out there that actually says that. So we'll still clip some of these. We'll clip elective ones more frequently because it's a more permanent result. There you have it. The recurrence rate on coiling is about 20%. So a lot of patients don't want to be dealing with this for the next 50 years of their life. They kind of want to be done with it. And so a lot of patients will still opt for surgical clipping, and we're still taking care of these. The patients who have ruptured, who we are assessing and evaluating how we're going to treat, represent an interesting bunch of folks. Here's why. They have an unsecured aneurysm in the brain that is more likely to rupture with higher blood pressure, yet they also have a very intense inflammatory cascade going on in their brain, typically also with increased intracranial pressure. And so the tendency, of course, would be to want to maximally perfuse and decrease inflammatory cascade. Yet the several different modalities of treatment will actually add insult and more likely a result of a rehemorrhage. And so obviously ABCs are super important. We'll typically pick a systolic of less than 160, but we don't want these patients less than 120 because honestly, we want to maximize perfusion too. We're walking that very fine line. Oftentimes these patients will get ventriculostomies and robust laboratory data. We really want to maintain euvolemia in as much as possible. Seizure prophylaxis and nimodipine are important. If you work in the emergency department setting, nimodipine is not important to give in the emergency department. The studies show that only after 21 days do we start seeing meaningful outcome data. So the first 2 or 4 hours, it's much more important to focus on the patient and actually maintaining normal tension during that time. A few other thoughts here. After surgery or after treatment, including endovascular coiling, it's a totally different scenario. And in that case, we'll really allow these patients to have very high blood pressures because what we're really worried about is the microperfusion. It's the arterioles and the capillaries that tend to have vasospasm and cause real issues here. And so we really want to maximally perfuse these folks. And so you'll see ridiculous parameters. You know, please maintain systolics 160, 180, 200. And that's based upon a theory of a triple H. Triple H is something that will eventually go away, but it's actually not a bad basic algorithm, which is making sure that the blood is maximally perfused throughout the body and also making sure that we have at least euvolemia in the blood. So if you've got a CBP of 6 and a patient who's got low urine output and a subarachnoid hemorrhage, that's a bad scenario. If you've got a medicine doc who wants to put the patient from a subarachnoid hemorrhage onto a cardine drip to get that blood pressure down, that's not what we want, and that's really not what's best for the patient. So in the same mantra of teamwork, sometimes we have too many team members, and it's going to be a little confusing, and you guys are typically the point people for that, so sorry about that ahead of time. But in any case, Vasospasm is the last thing I'll talk about. And vasospasm is a real problem in patients with subarachnoid hemorrhage. And it really is the major cause of morbidity after treatment. And it can occur in any of the different treatment algorithms that we have out there. So it's important that maintaining adequate perfusion and euvolemia or hypervolemia is important, and specifically avoiding hypovolemia. I'm going to stop there. Any questions at all? Sandy. Right, so Sandy's question is, in the OR setting, are there any rule of thumb regarding the use of a ventriculostomy catheter? And the answer is, typically, if it's an issue where they're going to wake up, if we think they're going to wake up and do okay, then it's less likely we're going to need one. If we think this is an ill patient who will likely not be extubated after surgery, then it's a patient that we're more likely going to need. And I think that's probably the general thing. Let's treat the patient here. If the patient's going to be super sick after surgery, we'll probably put it in the trip. If not, then probably not. Okay. Any other questions?
Can you speak to vasospasm and monitoring and treatment?
Yeah. So Josh wants to know about vasospasm, monitoring, and treatment. There isn't a great way to monitor for vasospasm. We've tried TCDs, which are transcranial Dopplers, which are notoriously inaccurate with high inter-observer error, and don't necessarily have any significant prognostic implications. We've also used angiogram and CTA as ways of assessing that. Probably the best case scenario, and the best way that we can do this is, again, with our clinical exam. And this is what's shown time and time and time again. 30% of patients who have a subarachnoid hemorrhage will have some evidence of radiographic vasospasm. That means you can see it on the x-ray, you can see it on the ultrasound, you can see it on the CTA. That's much less important than symptomatic vasospasm. Symptomatic vasospasm is a post-bleed day 10 patient who all of a sudden is more somnolent, who all of a sudden can't lift an arm, can't move a leg, or other types of clear focal findings. That is an emergency. The others, radiographic findings where, yeah, they've got some vasospasm on the CTA, I just looked it up, or I looked at the scan, versus that is really important. How do we treat that? Well, if they have bad vasospasm, at this point, a lot of times we'll ship them. We'll ship them down to Swedish where they can actually shove a catheter up there and balloon dilate that. 99 times out of 100, that's typically not necessary. We can typically hyperperfuse these patients, put these patients on pressors, and physically squeeze the blood through there. Nimodipine is a calcium channel blocker that's well accepted that we'll use as a prophylaxis against this. We're coming up with some other agents that are actually going to be helpful, but those won't be online for the next 3 to 5 years. Last question.
Can you send people home on the nimodipine?
So the question is, can you send people home on nimodipine? Yes, you can, although it's a pain in the butt to get. But yeah, typically we will send people on nimodipine for 21 days. But nimodipine is typically only used in subarachnoid hemorrhage. So a lot of times patients will have vasospasm for other reasons, we don't use it. It's a very expensive drug, and so if you've got an indigent or underinsured patient, we'll need to start working on that with social work long before they go home, because that's a drug that none of us can afford. Thank you very much.